Welcome to Talk Across America. I'm Doug Miles, and we're here in beautiful Sarasota, Florida.
This one is called Game of Snipers, part of the Bob Lee Swagger novel series. And Stephen Hunter joined us by telephone from up, I believe, in Baltimore today. And Stephen, good to talk with you. How are you?
I am very well, and I am indeed in Baltimore. I wish I'd seen that game last night. I don't know when this is running, but evidently our center fielder drove the game into extra innings with a ninth inning base hit. And then in the 16th inning, he came in as the closer. When we had scored two runs, and he got three, I guess the Los Angeles Angels, out with his famous 37-mile-an-hour fastball. So it was a great...
I heard about that.
What a few.
Yeah, the first position player to save a game, I believe, ever in baseball.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Exactly right. Yeah, amazing. Believe me, every one of our wins this year is amazing. This was more amazing.
We get to see them down here. Stephen, in spring training in Sarasota every year, and it was kind of tough this spring. There's not a lot, wasn't a lot of optimism, but at least maybe that'll be a turnaround. Who knows?
Everyone can dream, including me.
Well, you've had success in the past, so you can remember those great games, right? With Brooks and Frank and all those guys.
That's right.
Well, first of all, congratulations on the series' success, and anytime you can do, I guess this is number 11, right? In the series on Bob Lee Swagger, that's a great accomplishment for an author.
Well, they tell me it's 11 too. I've never counted. It's just sort of a blur, and I guess I've been pretty busy over the last 30 years or so. It's been, I don't think of it in terms of books. I think it in terms of units of fun. And I have had experience with many units of fun, and that satisfies me. This one is a unit of fun.
I should say you're also, for the people not aware, you were the film critic for the Washington Post for many years, so you've had that.
That is correct. Yes.
Background in film, and you moved into writing these thriller novels. And I guess for two people that may not be aware of Bob Lee Swagger, give a little synopsis, and then we'll talk about the book. Give a little a plot rundown, if you could.
Okay. Well, Bob Lee Swagger is a former Marine sniper. He served in Vietnam. He's old. He's much older than Mark Wahlberg, who played him in the movie.
Right.
What's happened to him is that he's got a gift for firearms. He is a superb shot. But more important than that, he also has a mind that's extremely insightful as to what happens when the guns come into play. He's able to understand things and see possibilities and track things down and understand things how happen. And that's a gift. It's almost like autistic, but it's a gift that's very helpful to law enforcement. And over the years, he's become more of a detective and less of a shooter. In this particular book, however, this is a straight manhunt book. He learns through a intelligence breakthrough that a jihadi sniper, a very high quality shooter and strategist, a guy as good as he is, has been smuggled into America. And from that, and from the weapon that he was using, they infer that he's going to take a shot on a high-value target. And Bob is part of an FBI task force. He's not the leader of it. He's just one of the consultants in which they're going to try, obviously, to stop this guy, to intercept him. And so the book follows these two guys as they crisscross America and play cat and mouse, except that the mouse is no mouse. He's also a cat. So it's a game of cat and cat across America. And every time they get close to each other, there's a gunfight. But somehow this guy is so good that he's able to keep it up. And what I was trying to get to was an ultimate moment when Bob Lee Swagger, and I thought this is what his fans would really like to see, when Bob Lee Swagger has to take the big shot for all the marbles. He's the man who's got to do it or something terrible happens. And that's what we're producing. That's the gist of the book and the gist of my summarization of it.
Yeah, that's a great premise there. The character, people get familiar with it, but you found a way to really put the pressure on him, right? It's not easy for him, so that's a great kind of ultimate scene, I imagine, in the book. Won't tell it, of course, but I mean that's what I think the readers want to see, right? Him under complete different kind of pressure, right? That's why I'm talking about.
Exactly. And one of the things I've done, for better or for worse, in the opinions vary, is I've kept his age real. He is age. He has been in the passage of history. History is actively reflected in his, as he moves through it, changing of the decades, the changing of the culture, the changing of everyday life, the demographic changes. And he is now an old man. He's not as strong or as sharp or as quick or as gifted physically as he once was. And so the issue is not merely can he find the guy, but if it comes to it, is he still capable of getting the job done? And maybe he's too old. Maybe he's lost whatever it was that made him special. It happens. And writing that was very interesting to me, because guess what? I'm old too, and I like creating the mind, and I like seeing an older guy as a hero. I'm not that interested in 35-year-old men anymore. So I'm just, you know, this is what I do. I have no other choice. It's the book I chose to write, and I'm glad I did.
I was going
to
say, in addition, there you mentioned, you know, the character is aging in real time, so to speak. But are there other ways the character has changed from book one, attitude, that kind of thing? Do you write it that way? Or
The one thing that books have traced is his reentry into society. I mean, one of the things I felt, he was a Vietnam veteran, and he felt the melancholy and the isolation of the Vietnam veteran. And I always thought that was a violent wrong in our society, that those guys had to go through that. And right. One of the things that I've tracked is his reemergence in society and his reacquisition of his place in society. I mean, he is the warrior prince, and he deserves, he's earned respect and honor and appreciation. And for so long, it was denied him. And one of the things the books have been about is how he got his place back, how he got his society back. And he's also done that for other snipers. One of the things with the books, once I had gotten him back, I got other snipers back, other warriors who had been isolated or exiled. And that's sort of been the underlying themes of the books. And I will say that in this book, that's an assumption. One of the assumptions is that he is fully back. So it is slightly thematically different if you're keeping track of that sort of information.
Yeah. And again, we mentioned this is the 11th installment. I imagine you get emails or messages on Twitter or Facebook from the fans that like the character, right? To give you ideas or feedback. Did you get a lot of that?
Yes and no. I've not really done a whole lot about making myself a public figure.
Right.
And I think a lot of people think that I'm more of a recluse than I really am. I'm sure not J.D. Salinger or Thomas Pynchon. I'll tell you that. I'm still listed in the phone book. And I do. One thing that I seem to get out, and I don't really understand this, but yeah, I have a lot of friends on Facebook. Now, I'm one of the worst Facebook people on earth. My Facebook page is a disgrace. I don't know why anyone would ever look at it. I almost never look at it. But I do get a lot of action on it, and a lot of people who want my friendship, and I was like asking, what exactly do you think you're going to get out of this? Let me tell you, not a damn thing. But if you want to be my friend, sure, why not? So
make people feel good, I guess.
Yeah, it makes them.
Well, the book is called Game of Snipers, a Bob Lee Swagger novel, number 11 in the series. We're talking today with Stephen Hunter. And Stephen, we won't give out the Facebook page, but do you have a website you want to direct people to get the book?
I think it's, well, there's two web books. One is a professional website, which I believe, Facebook page, which is run by Putnam's, and that's Stephen Hunter. And then there's my own private, dowdy, pitiful, tepid little website, which is called Steve Hunter. Facebook Steve Hunter, and they can keep up with the latest. I think there's also a website that a guy did for me for free because he wanted to see what it like to have a website, but he got bored. So the website is frozen in the year 2004. So if you want to catch up with me in 2004, I'm sure you can find the Stephen Hunter website.
A vintage website.
Yeah.
Well, Stephen,
the photography is very odd.
Stephen, pleasure talking to you, and I look forward to doing it again. And if you come down next spring to see the Orioles, look us up here. We'd love to see you at the ballpark.
That would be great fun. I can't wait.
Thank you for joining us today on Talk Across America. Please visit our website at DougMilesMedia.com for more great interviews and content. And if you're interested in any of the books we talk about on the program, please click the Amazon link on our website. It helps support the podcast. Thanks for listening. We'll see you again real soon here from beautiful Sarasota, Florida.
I'm Stan Brock. 30 years ago, I formed Remote Area Medical to help people overseas. But then we found generations of families in America, isolated by poverty from the health care they need. Together, we can take dental, vision, and medical help to a million adults and their kids, right here at home in the United States of America.